Welcome to this video of Strength of Materials. In this video, we are going to talk about stress strain curve for a mild steel specimen, also known as low carbon steel, ductile steel, or Fe250 in engineering terms. So let's dive into this lecture. Stress strain curve is a curve drawn between stress and strain values of a mild steel specimen tested on a universal testing machine, and the machine is called universal because it can be used for measuring shear tension, compression, flexure, torsion, etc. And it is done to record the amount of deformation in the specimen and to reveal the properties of material. So a universal testing machine kind of look like this, as you can see on the screen, and the specimen is kept within these two arms of the machine. This machine tries to pull this specimen and creating a tensional stress inside the material to know the amount of deformation and to reveal its properties. So first of all, let's draw our axis with strain on x-axis and stress on y-axis. So just to remind you that stress is the force applied per unit area and strain is the change in length divided by the total length. And strain has no dimension, stress is measured in Newton per mm square or megapascal. So as we start applying tensional force on our specimen, the strain increases in proportion to the stress. That is, stress is directly proportional to strain up to point A. And the curve shows a linear variation, and the zone is called as linear elastic zone. Why this zone is called as linear elastic zone? Because in this region, Hooke's law is valid. And what is Hooke's law? Hooke's law is stress is directly proportional to strain, which includes a constant of proportionality E, which is equal to stress is divided by strain, and therefore can be said as a slope of this linear curve. And this E is known as modulus of elasticity. Since the stress is proportional to strain only up to point A, this point A is called as proportionality limit. On further application of stress, our material reaches to elastic limit and we name it as point B, and up to this point the material is elastic and this region is non-linear elastic region, and the path from A to B is slightly curved, therefore Hooke's law is not valid in this region. And in actual engineering graphs, in real graphs, this point B is very near of point A for mild steel, but for other materials, B is kind of far from A. So just to demonstrate point A and B, I have drawn point B farther from A, but in actual conditions, they are very near. Alright, on application of further more load, the stress values increases and this graph reaches up to a point C, and this point C is called as upper yield point. And after this point, the resistance of the material suddenly drops down and the material becomes unstable, and this depends on the shape or size of the specimen. Since the internal resistance of the material drops down up to a certain limit, we name it as point D, and it is called as the lower yield point, and it is preferred in designing purposes. The stress at this value is taken as design stress for limit state method, working stress method, ultimate load method, and plastic theory. And this point is known as actual yield point of our mild steel specimen. After this point D, on a very small increase in load, the deformations are very large as compared to the load applied, which means that the strain values are very large as compared to the stress applied. So which means that on a relatively smaller increase in stress, it shows a very large value of strain, and this region indicates the permanent deformation in our mild steel specimen, and this region is called as perfectly plastic region, and it continues up to point E. So on further application of load on this specimen, the curve from E reaches to a point F, which is the ultimate stress point, because this point shows the maximum stress that our specimen can bear during its service life. And in this region between E to F, the strain increases with faster rate and our specimen undergoes change in atomic and crystalline structure, resulting in increased resistance for further deformation. That is why this region is called as strain hardening region, and it is not used for design purposes. After this ultimate stress point, on further application of load, the area of cross section drastically decreases and a neck kind of shape starts producing in our specimen. And on further application of load, the diameter starts decreasing, resulting in breaking of our specimen. And the point at which our specimen breaks is called as fracture point or brittle point, and the corresponding stress is called as breaking stress, and the corresponding strain is called as fracture strain. And the region between F to G is called as necking region, and one of the writers has mentioned it that from point F to G is called as strain softening zone. I'm not sure about it. You can cross check it in your books. But this region is called as necking region, which I'm sure about. And from O to D, the strain is called as elastic strain. And from D to G, the strain is called as plastic strain. And the upper yield point, that is point C, is normally found at 0.2% of strain, that is at a value of 0.002. So this was pretty much about the stress strain curve. There are a few more types of stress strain curve which I'll show you in the next part of this video. If you found this video helpful, then please hit that like button. It really motivates me to create more videos for you. And if you have any doubt, query or suggestion, then you can tell me in the comments below. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel, because more videos like this are coming for you. Cheers.